On the 10th of June 1960, Trans-Australian Airlines, known as TAA, Flight 538 was on approach at night to land at Mackay, Queensland, when it crashed into the sea, killing all 29 people on board. The accident led to major safety developments still in place to this day, but more on that later. This was TAA's first Fokker Friendship F-27 aircraft, and TAA was the first airline outside of Europe to order the type. TAA's Director of Engineering, John L. Watkins OBE, accepted the aircraft, registered VHTFB, at the Fokker Works near Schiphol Airport, Amsterdam, on the 6th of April 1959. The aircraft was christened Abel Tasman after the Dutch explorer who was the first European to reach parts of Australia in 1642. On the late afternoon and evening of Friday, 10th of June 1960, VHTFB was flying TAA Flight 538 from Brisbane to Mackay with stops at Maryborough and Rockhampton. It left Brisbane on time at 5 p.m. under the command of Captain F.C. Pollard with G.L. Davis as first officer. They arrived at Rockhampton Airport at 7:12 p.m., where the crew received the weather forecast for Mackay, predicting shallow fog patches. The plane was refueled to 700 gallons, giving sufficient range to continue to Townsville if fog made it impossible to land at Mackay. Adding to the 9 passengers already aboard, 7 adults boarded, along with 9 boys from Rockhampton Grammar School, heading home for the weekend. The plane departed from Rockhampton at 7:52 p.m. and ascended to 13,000 feet. At 8:17 p.m, Mackay Air Traffic Controller E.W. Miskell reported that fog had rolled in and temporarily closed Mackay Airport. A few minutes later, having come to the spot where he would usually start descending, Captain Pollard told the tower controller he would hold over Mackay Airport at 13,000 feet in case visibility improved. At 8:40 p.m, they reported they were over the airport. It was a bright, moonlit night with completely calm sea, and the crew attempted 2 approaches but failed due to a low layer of cloud on the coastline, obscuring sight of the runway for final approach. By 10 p.m, the fog was thinning. Air traffic controller Miskell reported this to the plane, and Captain Pollard said they would begin an approach to the airport. Miskell reported the airport conditions. Pollard acknowledged the transmission. Miskell then telephoned the airport fire service for the latest ground temperature. It was 13 degrees Celsius. Miskell reported this to the plane. This time, there was no acknowledgement. Miskell transmitted again, noting the time was 10:05 p.m., and again, there was no reply. At 10:10 p.m, Miskell started the procedure for launching a search and rescue operation. 5 hours after the accident, at about 3 a.m. in the morning of Saturday, 11th June, a searchlight-equipped motor launch found items of wreckage, including damaged passenger seats, clothing, and cabin furnishings floating on the ocean between Round Top Island and Flat Top Island, 5 nautical miles due east of Mackay Airport. A Navy survey ship, the HMAS Warrego, was sent to search for sunken wreckage and arrived on Sunday, the 12th of June. At 4:20 p.m. that afternoon, Warrego discovered the major sections of the plane in 40 feet of water, a further 4 nautical miles southwest of Round Top Island. Salvaging the wreck took another 2 weeks, assisted by HMAS Kimbla and clearance divers from Sydney. There were no survivors. To this day, it remains the second worst air disaster in Australian commercial aviation history. A Board of Accident Inquiry was appointed on 29 July. After allowing investigators to inspect the wreckage, it finally opened on the 4th of October. The board sat for 4 days in Brisbane and 2 more in Mackay before concluding on the 10th of November. The board was chaired by Justice Spicer of the Commonwealth Industrial Court. The inquiry did not determine a particular cause. The aircraft had flown into the ocean for no apparent reason, so the board focused on the altimeter. One possibility was that the static pressure system, or altimeter, was malfunctioning, Another possibility was that reading of the three-pointer altimeter was misinterpreted, has individual pointers for thousands, hundreds, and tens of feet, and can be difficult to interpret. Errors of 1,000 or even 10,000 feet were common. As a consequence, three-pointer altimeters were later removed from service. Another possibility was given by TAA's Director of Engineering, John L. Watkins OBE, who was intrigued by a mysterious brown glass medicine bottle discovered in the wreckage of the cockpit. Watkins theorized that one of the school children on the flight may have been an aviation enthusiast and had been shown into the cockpit while handling a bottle of model aircraft fuel. At some point, the bottle's contents may have spilled, distracting the pilots enough for them to make a mistake. Frank McMullen, TAA's Technical Services Engineering Superintendent and F-27 Project Engineer, formed the view that at the third attempt to land, the crew adopted a low flight path and put the left wingtip into the water while turning for the runway approach. What do you think caused Flight 538 to crash? Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Having found no definitive cause of the accident, one of the recommendations made by the Board of Accident Inquiry was that passenger-carrying aircraft the size of the F-27 and larger should be equipped with flight data recorders. Australia became the first country to mandate the carriage of cockpit voice recorders, a trend that was later followed by other countries. Air crash investigators worldwide owe a debt to the tragic events of Friday, 10th of June, 1960, and the 29 lives lost on that foggy night just off the coast of Mackay, Queensland. If you enjoy our videos, please like and subscribe, and we'd love to hear from you in the comments.